Okay, I think we're going to begin today's meeting. The Assembly Education Committee is holding an oversight informational hearing on our new Common Core state standards, its implementation challenges and opportunities. And I'd like to thank all of you who are here for your interest in this topic and your attendance. And I certainly want to acknowledge the members who are joining us, and I'm sure members will be coming and going because there's a lot going on in the Capitol today. But thank you, Mr. Amiano, and Ms. Halderman, and Mr. Wagner, and Mr. Williams for being here. So last year, as part of the California's Race to the Top application, the legislature approved and the governor signed SB 1 of the fifth extraordinary session. Among other things, SB 1 created the Academic Content Standards Commission to develop and recommend academic content standards in language arts and mathematics. The bill required that at least 85% of these standards consist of the Common Core state standards for each subject area. The bill went on to say that California must ensure the rigor of the state's reading, writing, and mathematics academic content standards, curricula, and assessments is maintained so that all high school graduates are prepared for college and careers by establishing a process to adopt new standards based on the Common Core Standards Initiative. On August 2nd of 2010, the State Board of Education adopted the Common Core Standards. However, as most of you know, we face some fiscal challenges in the implementation of these standards. And due to our fiscal crisis, the state has suspended instructional material adoption activities, and the funds dedicated to instructional materials and professional development have been cut and put into categorical flexibility. As far as assessment, our state testing system will sunset in 2 years, and we're still awaiting reauthorization of the Federal Elementary and Secondary Education Act. Additionally, there are national assessment initiatives that are being considered at the State Board of Education, as we speak. I'd like to mention that while assessment is a very important part of this conversation, you'll notice that assessment on today's agenda is not really there. We are planning on having a separate hearing in the future, focusing specifically on assessments. We're holding this hearing in order to move forward in the discussion of how the state should proceed in the implementation of the new Common Core standards so that we can align instruction, learning, and assessment with those new content standards. That alignment will allow us to move closer to a full vision of access to a higher quality education for all students in the state. So I'm looking forward to hearing what our presenters have to say today and hopes that this meeting will generate questions and discussions around this important topic. And before we invite our first panelists, if there were any members that wanted to make any comments, I would invite them now. Welcome, Ms. Butler and Mr. Ng. Thank you for being here. Seeing no members, Mr. Amiano. Excellent. Very good. Thank you very much. So the first witness for today's hearing is Dr. Charles Weiss, who is the Santa Clara County Superintendent of Schools. Dr. Weiss's history of service to the state's public schools and statewide effort in curriculum and accountability are too long to recite. That said, his contributions as a member of the Public School Accountability Act Advisory Committee since the 1990s, and then as a member of the Academic Content Standards Commission last year, are notable in the context of this hearing. And as always, I look forward to hearing your testimony, Dr. Weiss. And with that, I'll ask you to begin. Thank you.
Am I on now? Can you hear me now? Okay. Thank you, Chairperson Brownlee, for inviting me, and members of the subcommittee, or the Assembly Education Committee, for inviting me to speak to you today. My job this morning is to talk, this afternoon, is to talk to you about where we are now and give you some recommendations on where we need to go from here. So, Chairperson Brownlee gave you a good background on what's happened to date, but let me just reiterate that in the past, each state had a set of standards. There were at least 50 different standards around the nation. And so the governors and the chief state school officers got together in 2009 and decided that it would be in their best interest to have some common standards. Because especially under NCLB, where we're being reported upon how many students are proficient, if proficiency has different levels of different states, we don't know what that means. So in September of 2009, the college and career readiness standards were released, and actually, then they went through a series of vettings and hearings, and they became the foundation for the Common Core state standards. California Senate Bill 1 of the fifth extraordinary session established a 21-member academic content standards commission to develop standards in mathematics and English language arts. It stated that 85% of the standards were to consist of the Common Core standards, with up to 15% additional material. In addition, it directed the State Board of Education to adopt or reject the recommendations of the commission. So I did serve on that commission, and we got a whopping 6 days to get that job done. Now, for those of you that don't know what a miracle that is, I think Jerry Shelton was in the Department of Education when the first standards were developed in 96, 97. It took 18 months, 24 months, something in that nature. So we had 6 meetings in the months of June and July of this last year. And we were very effective and efficient because even though we finished at about 11:30 p.m. on the 6th day, we did adopt the Common Core standards and recommend that the State Board adopt them. So the standards, we got very familiar with them over those 6 days with the help of the Sacramento County Office of Education that did crosswalks from our existing standards to the new standards. With the training that we had from some of the people that crafted the new standards, we found out what the real benefits to them would be. And what we found out was that it built on our current state standards. They were rigorous, research-based standards in English language arts and mathematics for grades K through 12. They were designed to prepare the nation's students with knowledge and skills needed for success in college and in the workforce. They were internationally benchmarked to ensure that students were globally competitive. They put an educational framework that is consistent with and clear to parents, teachers, and the general public. I want to emphasize that. This set of standards, especially in English language arts, is so much easier to understand for anyone because it has a set of common skills that go throughout the grade levels. So you can see how they're growing and building on one another. Our standards had some of that, but they didn't have it consistently. We do have that now. So therefore, we're able to map growth across grade levels, and they're not course-based, but content, concept-based. So the good news is, in August, as Julia said, the State Board did adopt our recommendation, and the Common Core standards are now the standards for the state of California. Now, the background on that is that we were under a time constraint because we were a candidate for the Race to the Top funds at that time. We did not get the Race to the Top funds, and there'll be another round of Race to the Top, but we'll be positioned for that if there's funding for it. So the next steps. I was in the meeting this morning with the presentations by the two assessment consortia. Let me talk a bit about that, and then I'll tell you what I think the next steps are. There are two consortia of states put together to create assessments for the Common Core. This is really a good opportunity because rather than every state developing a set of assessments, they're going to be developed by a consortia of states. And there are two consortia in place right now, the PARC consortia, which stands for Partnership for Assessment of Readiness and College Careers, for college and careers, and the other one is the Smarter Balance consortia. And they each have their strengths and weaknesses, and we heard their presentations this morning. But the bottom line on these is that they will be a new way of assessing, different than our California standards tests. There'll be more critical thinking in it. There'll be more along the lines of international assessments, which is solving problems, applying knowledge, things like that. So we think that has great benefit for us. So what has to happen now? Well, first thing that has to happen is that we need to have a common message about the Common Core standards so that the general public begins to understand that these are the standards of the state of California. I think it's still kind of in the background. The second big thing that needs to happen is we need to transition information for educators, students, and parents to know when these things are going to roll out. I mean, I think everyone's heard about it a little bit in education, but they really don't know when it's coming. Some people think it happened yesterday. Some people think they were supposed to be doing it tomorrow. The reality is we need to have a timeline for getting that out. And part of that timeline is we need to demonstrate the bridge of Common Core to our existing standards. Because what you'll find when you take a look at these, it's not a dramatic change in direction. It's a refinement and an enhancement of our current rigorous standards. There's been no reduction in rigor in these standards. And so we're recommending that the bridge be made explicit with crosswalks and other materials being distributed. I think SB 140, Lowenthal, recommends developing, create a list of supplemental materials aligned to the Common Core. So that's the kind of thing that we need to do to get the word out. And then finally, we need a plan. And this morning in the presentations by both of the consortia, they said that the consortia would work with our plan to roll out the Common Core assessments. And so one of the board members turned to the chair and said, "Do we have a plan?" And the answer was, "We're working on it." And that's good. We need to be working on it. We need to have a master plan in place that gives target dates, starts to explain how we'll provide professional development for teachers to understand the Common Core. We need to take a new approach to developing frameworks and textbooks, because the fact that we're in a consortia suggests that we don't have to do it all alone. And so we can really work with the other states that are developing these, and hopefully there'll be some cost savings associated with that. So finally, what can the Assembly Education Committee do to get the ball rolling, which is what I was asked? I believe that working in a consortia of states is not the same as working in California alone. And so we have a lot of history in the California Department of Education with developing frameworks, putting out standards, having textbook companies respond to them, things like that. I think that we can work in a consortia and do that together and therefore reduce our costs. I know the Department of Education did an estimate for the state board of a cost of about $2.1 million to get this done. That may be correct, but if we look at this differently and say, how can we work together and work with the two assessment consortia, because they have funds to help pay for some of these activities, then I think we can save money and get the job done even better. The next thing is we need to consider revoking the suspension on instructional materials. As you know, the revocation goes to 2013-14, and the problem with that is the pilot testing will be done in 2013 and 14 of these two consortia. What we know in instructional strategies is you don't test kids on things they haven't been taught. So the reality is we need to get the instruction going before we do the assessments. And so we need to figure out how we get materials to teachers before the 2013-14 year. And where will the money come from this? Well, we believe it might be the right time to reduce the statewide assessment system for a period of time to the minimum required by NCLB, take that same money, put it into professional development and supplemental material development so that people can begin to work with these standards over time. And let's see. And also, the other thing we need to do, if we're going to be involved in either of these consortia, because one of the criteria of the consortia was the use of computers to do the tests. The rationale behind using computers is that the results get back quicker. The stuff that can be standard scored are scored that way. And frankly, out in the schools right now, we don't have enough computer access to make that happen in every school. So that's another place we need to invest or enter into a partnership with one of our Silicon Valley neighbors to make that available here in California. So we think that we can reduce the costs by changing some of the ways we do things. We think we can reduce the costs by not doing the same way we did last time of developing frameworks in the same methodology. We can reduce the cost by not having to order our own set of textbooks, but they can be across the consortia. We think we can also reduce the costs and provide economy of scale through cloud computing. And I'm not sure that the consortia has thought about this, but in California, we are experimenting in some of our county offices with large cloud computing networks, which would enable us to use dumb terminals at the school site, which would be much cheaper. So we think we're poised, and we're excited about the opportunity to create some real change in the way we do business here in California, and not just do business as usual now that we're part of this broader consortia with these Common Core standards.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, and for all the members, I don't want to preclude a conversation on assessments. I just, in our planning process, we knew that the decisions by the State Board of Education, where California is going to be. All of this is going to be happening down the road. I think we want to have parallel conversations about, I mean, California may want to do additional assessments that are aligned with what comes out of the consortium. So that's the reason why I wanted to delay it. But we certainly, I don't want to preclude the conversation. And because you brought it up, I wanted to know, actually, you said you were over at the State Board earlier this morning. And did they take any kind of action relative to, I know that they have to sort of reaffirm California, where California wants to be and in what role they want to be and what consortia they want to be in. Mm-hmm. And just wondering if they had taken any action on that today.
No, as a matter of fact, they didn't, and they were advised that the State Board probably would not be taking action on that. That was what the staff advised them of. I'm not sure if that's exactly what will happen. But by May, they need to make a decision if they're going to stay in the consortia they're in, move up to a governance member of that consortium, or go to the other consortia, or have no consortia at all. So they have till May, because of the change in the governor and the SPI, to jump ship. And I'm sorry I brought up assessment, but in order to talk about curriculum, you have to think, when is the assessment coming? Because it's only fair to think, are the kids in the schools going to be assessed on this? When are they going to get an opportunity to learn it? And I just want to add one thing, because I forgot about it, but this week there was a call for common content, and some 75 leading educators around the nation said that a guideline should be developed across the consortia, across the states, not to develop a common curriculum, but to develop a common set of practices that will get kids ready for the Common Core assessments that are coming. And I really believe that what they've described here is exactly what needs to happen, and that is something we've not been particularly good at in California, and that is collaborating with other states to get this job done.
Thank you very much. Mr. Williams and then Mr. Amiano.
Of course, now I have a question on assessment. So did I hear that your recommendation is for us to dispense with having two testing regimes and only have one, the one required by by the federal government?
If you're looking to save some money and find money to put in professional development right now, there's no new money to do that with. And so the only thing to do is look at what can you stop doing. You know, in education, we're always trying to develop stop doing lists. Right now, the only requirements for assessment are the No Child Left Behind requirements that I'm aware of. Now, you'd want to check that in the Public Schools Accountability Act. But if that's the case, then we can reduce the number of assessments we give. And again, I think we have a problem in California right now with two accountability systems. We don't need two separate assessment systems. This shouldn't lay over the top of it. This should replace most of our assessment system. And that's one of the reasons California needs to be in the governance seat on those two, whichever consortia we end up in.
And would that take a decision by the State Board and legislation to accomplish, or only one of the two?
I think it would take legislation, because STAR is authorized by legislation. Of course, your folks that do that kind of stuff would be better than me at that. But I think it would take some legislation to change that. And I think there's some bills pending to talk about reducing the number of assessments, aren't there? No, not yet.
Thank you.
But that's why you got to have a hearing on it.
Mr. Amiano.
Thank you. Well, I do have a lot of concerns, particularly around assessment, that and what I think is a narrow focus on testing, but we could develop that later, especially where are we going to get the hardware, because both consortia, it depends a lot on the computers. So I don't know. A little bit I'm feeling we're doing this by the seat of our pants. In terms of the subject areas, though, Common Core Standards focuses on English language, arts and mathematics, but what about the other subject areas like science and history and social studies? How are we going to ensure that our students are going to be successful in all those subject areas?
Thank you for the question. Very good question. The next phase of Common Core Standard development is history and science, history, social studies, and science. It will roll out a little bit slower, but they're working on it right now at the national level.
And then what capacity do we have at the staff level? Or in the legislature, to monitor and understand all this? This is an enormous, you know, purview. And where are we going to get that kind of staff? Where are we going to get the money for that kind of staff? Have even identified a portfolio to monitor the amount of work that has to be done?
Yeah.
See, I'm feeling that.
Yeah, I
hear
you.
We're talking here,
yeah,
but we don't got this.
Yeah.
And that's going to take
later me. On in the discussion here, we will have people from the department, and I think those questions might be better
But I could
yes, please, go
form
ahead.
An answer. I think that because the department has had to take so many cuts over the last several years, they are very thin, and we understand that. But we also have county office of education that have geared up for this. For example, we couldn't have gotten the Common Core standards done if it wasn't for the Sacramento County Office of Education staff. So I think we need to look at county offices as partners with the Department of Education to do this work, as well as the larger districts that have staff still. They still have staff and curriculum, not much left, but still have some staff and curriculum. So I think we just have to use the existing staff we have. If we wait to have enough staff to do this or to find enough money to do this, we will never do it, and our kids will miss out. And so I think it's really important to move ahead even in these thin times.
Any other questions, Mr. Romiano? Mr. Wagner.
No, appreciate it.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And a quick point and then maybe just a quick question. In my work on the budget committee, there has been some talk of cloud computing, which was fairly new concept to me. I've had a chance to dig into it a little bit, and it looks like it may well be a direction the state moves. So to hear you suggest that in delivering education, we move in that direction was frankly quite intriguing and quite encouraging. So I think that may have an opportunity for some real cost savings throughout the system if we're able to move in that direction. And I think it's generally the way the world is going. So I encourage some outside of the box thinking and taking a look into that. But to follow up on a question from Mr. Williams with respect to assessment, and maybe this two-tier system and we can save some money, can you give me an idea how much money we might be able to save? What is the dollar value attached to that? And I understood maybe there isn't any legislation pending. If it's going to take some legislation to realize those savings, maybe that's something that you can work with the committee on, and maybe we move in that direction.
It's funny. I can actually answer that question. My understanding is
it doesn't always happen with witnesses at our hearings. Thank you.
It's about $13 per pupil. Per test given per year.
That $13. Adds up.
So depending on the number of kids you take out of the assessment system, you can save $13 approximately.
Okay.
That one I know. The other one is, my office
year.
Is in Silicon Valley. So we have just invested in a cloud computing network with Cisco, and it is going to have tremendous benefits for our schools. We can hang instructional materials in there. We can hang all kinds of things in there that can be downloaded to schools without having to have huge investments of large storage at the school district level. So we really think it has great potential for the future. For things like assessment, we think it has huge potential because it's interactive.
Thank you.
Thank you. And just one question or final question for me at least. So. Having gone through the 1997 adoption of standards and the implementation on that, are there things, having gone through that process, is there advice that you can give us? Are there things that we should not do or repeat again in this process, or things that we did well in that process that we should be carefully considering?
Well, my quick answer to that is that you've already done something right in only giving us 6 days to do the Common Core adoption, because we could have easily taken
that's a money saver right there.
The fact that you're working against a deadline always gets you to get it done. And we made a commitment as a 21-member commission to stay on the sixth day until we got it done, even though we had a couple of members that wanted to keep us from doing that. So that was the first right thing. I think the other thing is to see the benefit in it rather than focusing on the controversy. There are some controversy in these standards. I think the biggest controversy is the fear of tracking at the eighth grade level in mathematics. And it's something that we need to make everyone aware of, and we need to make sure it does not happen. And there are a number of studies. In fact, one of the speakers we have behind me will tell you about a study being done in her district, I believe, that where they broke the mold on placing kids in algebra and found out it really helped kids. And we're doing a study with Stanford in Santa Clara County, the same thing, placing kids in algebra. So I just want to make sure that that the Common Core standards don't get interpreted as a tracking system at the eighth grade level, that we do give kids every opportunity to be college ready by taking Algebra 1 as early as possible.
Thank
you. That's the only thing I can think of off the top of my head.
Thank you. And just one last question, actually, relative to some of the decisions that California needs to make with regards to staying where they are in one consortia or the other. So it sounds like there's already a decision-making process in place. And did the State Board, are they talking about having further discussions on that, or did they agendize it, or are there ways in which, the legislature could influence that process, understanding that we're not the decision makers on this particular point?
I left the meeting before they announced whether they were agendizing it again. I know they'll continue to work on it, and I'm not sure what the legislature can do on that. I'm one of those people that feel if someone else has the authority, you stay out of it, but that's just my opinion.
And as if California chooses to become a governing member, how much money does that mean from the federal government? Do you have any idea?
As I understand what happened today, there is some amount of the money that goes to governing states, but it's not much. I mean, you wouldn't do it for the money. It's like Race to the Top. You wouldn't do it for the money. It just isn't enough money. The important thing about being a governing member is that we have the most diverse and largest state in the nation. We need to make sure that our kids' needs are being met by these consortia. And if we're not at the table every day that they're meeting, there's a real chance that won't happen.
Right.
Massachusetts was there today talking about the increase they have in English learners.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what, they have 4%.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that really is not the same as California's experience. And
your point about the money, though, is using all of the money that's been appropriated for the work that these two consortiums are going to do. That's what you're talking about.
And,
okay.
And because both consortia have plans to do training of teachers.
Right.
And do trainer's models, and they're paying for that. So that's some of the stuff that as a state we'd had to do out of our own budget. So there's a lot of opportunities there once we get engaged in one of those two consortia and we get confidence in the tool that we can use some of the federal money to roll those out. And again, it's not a lot of money, but with our structure of the Department of Education and the county offices and large districts, I think we can probably find ways to roll that out.
Great. Thank you so much. Any other questions?
A brief comment. I want to acknowledge Assemblywoman Buchanan because she did inform the caucus, the Democratic caucus, about the cloud computer, and then she had that, I guess it was an off-site in-service, or I'm not quite sure what to call it, but to acquaint us with it. So.
Yeah. She's been doing a lot of work in that area, and I'm sure will be a valuable resource to us as we move down this path. So thank you, Dr. Weiss. It's great to see you. We really appreciate you being here for this hearing. It's very, very helpful.
Thank you for having me.
So our second panel will talk about what educators need in order to implement the Common Core state standards. And we're fortunate enough to have two excellent and extraordinary educators with us. Our first is Kathy Harris, who is a teacher at Piner Elementary School in Santa Rosa and was also a member of the Academic Content Standards Commission. And Kathy has been an extraordinary teacher who has been in the field for many, many years with lots of experience, and it was a very important member to the Academic Content Standards Commission. So thank you for being here.
Thank you. Am I on? Yes?
Yes, you're
okay,
on.
Okay, good. Thank you. Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members of the committee. I am truly honored to be here, and I thank you for the opportunity to give you a classroom teacher's perspective on the implementation of both the adoption and the implementation of the Common Core Standards. I got involved with the Common Core Standards in about December of 2009 on the NCTE review panel, and then I was active actually on the development team for the standards with the text complexity, which is one of the very new pieces of it, and I won't go into detail with it, but it was very incredibly interesting work. I'm going to talk to you about what teachers feel we need in professional development, in instructional materials. There are some math issues, as Dr. Weiss mentioned. We have some concerns with administrators being so anxious to get involved that maybe they're making some wrong decisions along the way. And student access to the Common Core, including English learners. And, of course, assessment, which is a hot topic for today especially. But first I'd like to bring your attention to an integral part of the Common Core Standards, which are not part of our California adoption, unfortunately. On the Academic Standards Commission, we recommended adoption of the Common Core with every understanding that what's called the anchor standards would be part of that. So you should have a yellow piece of paper. I don't know if you got it yet. And the reason I'm taking the time to show you this is because when I first got involved with the Common Core, I was looking at all of the grade level standards. You'll see the anchor standards on one side. And if you turn it over where the gray bands are, those are those same 10 standards in, I picked third grade because that's my grade, in grades 3, 4, and 5. And so the beautiful, elegant thing about the Common Core standards is that these same 10 standards go throughout the grades. So once you understand in the anchor standards what students are expected to know and be able to do to be college and career ready, then you can go to your own specific grade level and see what the expectation is at that grade level. So I'm not sure, I feel like if we go forward with professional development, instructional materials, technical assistance, I believe it's critical that the anchor standards be part of that. I'm not sure what the solution is, but right now we definitely have a little bit of a hole in our adoption. So I appreciate you just taking a look at that. It's very interesting stuff. For professional development, teachers are extremely concerned that they get the professional development support that they need to really deeply understand the Common Core. In California, teachers are, we are so lucky because the Common Core is very highly aligned with our California standards. Some of the writers of the Common Core were the writers of our standards in 1997, so they are very aligned. And many of our standards, our frameworks, our instructional materials absolutely support the Common Core. But there are some important differences, and teachers, we know that. We know that there are some places in our standards and our frameworks that need to be tweaked. There's research to support that, what's working and what's not working. And teachers are anxious and excited to move ahead and make those new steps because we know where our kids are just not, somehow not getting the support that they need, especially in comprehension and vocabulary. So we want professional development to be a priority and to be a first step. It is very, very tempting, I think, to look at assessments and computers and instructional materials, and those pieces are critical. They're critical areas of support. But to the extent that teachers deeply understand the differences and have that foundation in the research, we can be full partners as we go forward to choose instructional materials for our districts, to interpret assessments. So that's really, and I'd like you to think back to the incredible foundation we have right now in professional development, started in 1996 with class size reduction, and teachers were required to take courses in the research that came to inform our 1997 standards and materials. So by the time the materials came, teachers were well grounded in the research, and we need that same kind of thing to happen with the Common Core. I would like to recommend that the state fully partner and take advantage of the California subject matter projects. Those projects have been instrumental in that long line of professional development that I decided not to list out because you probably know what it is. They are fully ready to assist with the ongoing high-quality site-based professional development that teachers need and want. And then the extra piece is the technical assistance for districts that really pays attention to helping teachers analyze student data and choose the right assessments, choose the right instructional materials, and provide that technical assistance to districts. So definitely don't forget the subject matter projects. For textbooks, I think teachers are, we are using our textbooks. We feel a certain amount of loyalty to them at this point. We've been using them for a very long time, and we'll probably be using them for a few more years. And we're just very concerned that the textbook costs don't overrun the cost of everything else, especially professional development, like I mentioned, professional collaboration time for people to really sit and look at what they've got and do planning together. So we want to make sure that the textbooks are aligned with the Common Core and that we have the expertise to use those books well. I would like to address the math issue at the commission level. it was a controversial issue, and I think that to look at where we are now, where we are is we have two parallel tracks in eighth grade for math, so that students who come out of seventh grade at the proficient or advanced level go into algebra in eighth grade. Those who are not ready for that go into a core class. What that does is it puts districts between a rock and a hard place. They can either put kids in the core class and then their participation rate is below what's required by the federal government, or they can put everybody in algebra and then the performance rate will be below what is required. Now, I think that the administrator that's going to speak next has some more updated information, but that was the concern of the commission. In addition to that, as Dr. Weiss mentioned, there was a concern about tracking. So that's definitely something we need to take a look at. The Common Core standards do not really address the needs of English learners or students with disabilities. I think that some of that came to light at the state board meeting. I was there as well, listening to the consortia present their plans. One of them had a pretty detailed plan for how to make assessment accessible to English learners and then how to recommend accommodations that make sense for English learners and kids with disabilities. That's really important. The Common Core standards really leave it up to states and local districts to meet the needs of their English learners and kids with special needs. So we still are, I don't know where we are on updating the ELD standards to align with the Common Core. That has to happen right away. So we really do need that. As you know, our population of English learners is large and growing. Luckily, we're learning what to do better. We have a research base now on how to teach English learners. So teachers are very, very interested in making sure that that stays at the forefront. Assessment, I think that's been talked about, and I'm not going to say a lot about it, except that teachers would appreciate being involved at every step of the way. We are the ones who give these assessments, schedule them, interpret them, talk to the kids about them. At this point, teachers in California and students in California are absolutely flooded with assessments. And I'm an assessment junkie. I love assessments, but even I get a little overwhelmed sometimes. So it would be great to take a look at that flood, maybe follow up on what Dr. Weiss said. We would love to see the elimination of second grade testing, at least take a break from it for a little while. Because at this point, it's very problematic for second graders to take the kinds of assessments we're asking them to do. If we can get those formative assessments online that kids can do, and I think that kids, young kids, they know more about computers than we do, so I'm not worried about that part. But I am worried about the appropriateness of the way that we're assessing our young children. So we've talked about professional development, assessment, materials, making sure that districts prioritize professional development. And I would like to thank you for the opportunity to be here with you, and I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We appreciate your presentation. Are there any questions from members, Mr. Amiano?
Well, as a former classroom teacher, I really applaud your presentation. I am very concerned, I was previous to the passage of this bill, about the special needs students and English language. And so perhaps, Madam Chair, in another setting, another education committee hearing, we could deal with that. I'd like to know what California's ready to do.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Norby, and welcome. Mr. Norby is a vice chair of our committee. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. To what extent is technology aiding in kids learning, and what extent is it helping them cheat? And I ask that question because I drill my daughter on her multiplication tables through the use of the flashcards, and then my other one's working on her calculator to figure out certain problems, and I'm not sure if she should be doing that or not. Recently, the German defense minister had to resign because it turned out he lifted much of his PhD thesis from Google. And yet Google is an important research tool. So as teachers, how do you do that, especially in areas like math and even more so in creative writing? Because at a time when not only spell check, is on computers, but grammar check, syntax check, and all the other things. Is it necessary to just do those assignments in class, or is there a way to incorporate the computer without it simply the kid using it to do his work for him? I don't have good answers to that, but where is the research or the trends or the policies on that going?
I think we have policies for plagiarism, policies for the use of calculators. From my perspective as a third grade teacher, my students know a lot about the computer. What they know about it and the way that they use it, I think they definitely need guidance in that. We could probably talk for an hour mm-hmm. about, you know, how they're using technology, but one thing you can know for sure, they are definitely using it. They know how to get on the computer, Google a subject, and what they do is go straight to the videos, because I'm doing a research project right now on mm-hmm. animals. That's what they want to do. They want to look at videos. I think one thing that we can do is start a little bit earlier showing them how to use different sources of information, mm-hmm. encyclopedias, books, computers, print things off the internet. That's fine, but that's not your report. You know, so they have to understand how to take notes and synthesize information and put information in their own words. And I think they have every ability to do that. And to the extent that we can show them early on how to use these tools and understand early on the things they really need to know in their own minds, like the multiplication facts, then we won't have as many problems later on with plagiarism in the later grades and cheating.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you so much, and I really, the things that you highlighted, I think, are very, very important for us to contemplate, and particularly, I think, your message around professional development and professional development being first, and not letting all of the other elements of this, and technology can be sparkly, and people like to talk about it, and then we could, you know, finance all of that and not do anything around the professional development piece, so I hear that. And in terms of instructional materials, if we were going to just look at that specifically, I mean, so are you, as a teacher, would you be looking for the traditional textbook, you know, with supplemental materials? Are you looking for a broader choice of instructional materials to choose from?
Well, I think the good news is that the Common Core standards are fewer, clearer, and higher. So the big idea was to reduce the load in each grade level, so there aren't so many discrete skills to teach. So that will help with the instructional materials. There's also more of a focus on discourse. There's more of a focus on informational text. There's more of a focus on critical thinking and doing, instead of, you know, taking in and showing on a multiple choice test. So teachers are going to need, and students are going to need, materials to help them do that. Good quality literature, good quality nonfiction that they can read. But I think that we can streamline it, and I think that we can maybe get away from, you know, boxes of stuff that are this big that are put out from publishers to meet the needs in every state. That's what they do. What else can they do, right? So they have the California version, but it also includes all the stuff that's in all the other versions. And it becomes overwhelming. So I think the fact that it will be a consortium developing these materials will really help us prioritize as teachers and as students. So we need that. We definitely need that. And then to have the instructional materials aligned with the assessments, right? So those groups hopefully are going to be working together. I think we heard something, and Chuck can help us remember that, if they are working together, and I think they are. And I know that the adoption criteria is well along, because I'm in touch with the text complexity people, and they're sending me updates. So as long as those two are aligned, I think we're going to be in good shape.
Yes, Ms. Buchanan.
Thank you. I was going to say some general comments, which I'll do mostly for the last panel. It seems to me that we really ought to consider how rigid we are as a legislature in terms of the use of instruction of dollars that you're allocated for instructional materials. There's nothing that drove me nuts more as a school board member than having to cut programs and at the same time replace math books or that were 2 or 3 years old. Because you remember this, I think it was 2003 or 2004, where we had to replace books that were a couple years old because a couple pages changed and they didn't happen to be approved at the right time in terms of being aligned with the standards. So it's my hope that we once we adopt the new standards, that we trust our educators more in terms of how they implement them and hold them accountable for the results, but not be so prescriptive that we limit the materials, because instructional materials are very expensive. And to the extent that, to the extent that you have such a range of media now to be able to implement in your lesson plans, I think we ought to be trusting educators to do that a little bit more and really get maximum value out of those dollars.
Mr. Norby.
Well, trusting educators, but also recognizing that we have 1,000 different independently elected school boards, and trusting legislators and empowering the school boards to make decisions, because just like city council members, they're in a better position to do that. It's fine to have statewide standards, state-approved textbooks, but I think we all agree that more and more realignment, if I can borrow a term that's been used to apply to counties, go to school districts in the form of more realistic categorical programs and allowing them to make those decisions, because they're the ones that are elected to do so. And those are political decisions, but in the best sense of the word. And when that politics is local, it might be more responsive. Thank you.
Yes, please respond.
I'm so glad that Mrs. Buchanan, I don't know how to address you, Member Buchanan. I'm so glad you said that, because one thing that we need to keep in mind is that as we move forward, we need to take a look at this idea that the instructional materials are the most important thing in the room, and that what teachers really need to do is all be on the same page on the same minute, which I hesitate to tell you, but it's true, that's still happening out there. Pacing guides that are so strict, the teachers feel like they've lost their professional judgment. So I would hope that as we go forward and adopt new instructional materials, that we build in the professional judgment of teachers on how to use them with the students that they have in front of them that year. Because that can change from year to year, depending on your kids, right? So thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your presentation. Thank you for being here. Did you have another question?
I did, the pacing guide. I'm glad you mentioned that. I remember when I first started teaching history at one particular high school, the history teachers all did sit down, and we divided up, and we agreed as to where we wanted to be in the beginning and toward the end. And I think that's important, especially in a chronologically based class, because the principal doesn't want to go in and say, oh, I love the Civil War, so I'm spending a whole semester on that, and that's good to do a little bit of that, but you need to pace yourself. The idea that you're doing the exact same thing every day, of course, is too rigid, because teachers come up with creative ideas, and some of the most creative ideas they come up with are when you're driving to school, you know, okay, I got a test in a couple of days, we've finished the material, what do I do now to help review it, and then you come up with something. So I think cooperatively teachers can come up with that, and I think it's very helpful. But the idea that they're all in lockstep every day is something, as you said, which is too restrictive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Norby. And thank you again, Ms. Harris. And we will now bring up Linda Kaminsky, who is the Assistant Superintendent of Curriculum for the Upland Unified School District and the former chair of ACSA's Assessment and Accountability Task Force. And again, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Chairperson Brownlee. I appreciate it, and members. Thank you for the opportunity to come. I deeply appreciate your interest in the topic and your willingness to consider it carefully. And I appreciate also some of the elements that are already being introduced in your bill, in AB 250. In particular, the move towards flexibility and responsibility for at the district level for the work that can go on there for selection of materials, so that there is a broad range of materials available that gives districts and teachers the ability to respond to the local needs that they see in their students. That's, I think, a step in the right direction. I also appreciate the thoughtfulness about recognizing that we do have to deal specifically and carefully, thoughtfully, to support all students, including English learners, including students with special needs, and that the materials that we need to receive need to include sufficient information and guidance to help teachers address those needs. I also appreciate the inclusion of the primary language assessment for all students who are participating in dual language programs. And finally, the accelerated timeline for movement as we transition to the Common Core standards, to the full implementation. And that's really mainly what I want to talk about today, is that we have had in our state a very comprehensive way of evaluating materials, of developing, thank you, developing frameworks, engaging the appropriate people in that process. But we're at a point now, if we follow that timeline, we will end up putting all of our teachers, our students, our families really in a kind of a catch-22 position where they will be assessed, students will be assessed, teachers in a sense will be assessed before they've had a chance to become familiar with the standards, to have any kind of professional development, or to have the resources to implement them fully. And we need to make sure that we correctly design the system to build capacity before we move into accountability, to make sure that people have an opportunity to implement things over a period of time, in fact, so that students get the benefits, so teachers get the benefits, so schools have a chance to do their best work. There was a recent report that came out from the Center on Education Policy that interviewed a number of states, 36 states that were had adopted the Common Core standards, and the questions were, you know, what are you going to change in your state systems? And interestingly enough, there were a couple items that were pervasive throughout the states that responded. 100% of them said that this will impact their assessments. About over 90% of them, 95% of them, said that this will impact their curriculum guides, their choice of instructional materials, the professional development that they need to implement. And the second question then is, how are you planning on doing this? When will you be able to do it? And I think it's a word of caution for us, because a number of these states have timelines that are a little more accelerated than what we would normally have. And I think there's something that we can learn through dialogue, through sharing, and Dr. Weiss mentioned earlier, a little bit of collaboration across states to help us also implement the standards as well and as fully so that teachers and students benefit from them. And in thinking about that, I wanted to share with you a couple things that I really think are guiding principles. Dr. Weiss mentioned some of the key points that ACSA feels very strongly, the Association for California School Administrators. But behind those are some specific details of what that could mean, as well as guiding principles. So, for example, becoming familiar with the standards speaks to the principle of making sure that we're supporting educators, that we're not providing a package of the, you know, the latest, greatest thing, and saying, you know, you all go figure it out yourself. Giving people the time to dig into that, to become familiar with it, to understand. Actually, in my district, I've started this already with teacher groups coming together to look at our current, the 1997 standards, the new Common Core standards, to find out where are the similarities, how do they build on each other, where are the differences, how does the emphasis change in terms of really a much stronger focus on critical thinking and reasoning, which is good. But there needs to be the beginning awareness of what that means, and time for teachers to develop that understanding and think about how it will impact their teaching and learning. In terms of transition dates, again, a guiding principle here really is that instruction precedes accountability. Students have to have the chance to learn. Teachers have to have the chance to teach before we assess them. So that, as the earlier speaker mentioned, the need for professional development, I would actually say she's absolutely right. And in fact, I would make professional development recursive throughout the whole process, so that we don't think we've done it once, we've checked it off, but that we engage ourselves in a cycle of continuous improvement as we become familiar with the standards, we begin to implement them, we look at models, exemplars of what the standard, what a model unit might be. All that kind of information can be very helpful for us. Finally, moving to bridging over, we've talked about the importance of having some supplemental materials. I think we also need exemplars. And one of the pieces of the standards that was not adopted, and I'd ask you maybe to go back and look at this too, is there are appendices to the standards that are quite well designed. For example, there's a whole section on writing with samples, anchor papers are called, of student writing, of what a excellent first grade writing looks like, what outstanding work looks like in the ninth grade. It's very informative for us to have a sense of what the expectation, what the level of expectation is, so that we understand what we're trying to take our students to. And I'd like to see all of our schools have the access to that information. And finally, in terms of a timeline for implementation, I've put together a sample for you, and you can change it however you want. But it's based on starting. We know that there will be some assessments, live assessments, if you will, in the year 2015. And if we really, truly want to have a well-developed, robust assessment that gives us useful information, we have to make sure we put the places in ahead of time, the pieces ahead of time that need to be there, that people know the standards, that they have the supplemental materials that they might need, the professional development that would support the use of it, opportunities, time for students to learn it. It usually doesn't happen in just 1 year. It usually takes a couple years to kind of, you dip your foot in the first time into the lake, and then you swim a little bit later. And that's what we'll see that our students will need too. But we can learn from other states, and we can learn from working with other states who've already begun to use some of the materials that are out there. That to this point, we haven't had the flexibility in our funding to adopt, but hopefully we will have greater flexibility. And then a couple of the points that were brought up, I wanted to share with you some of the work that we've been doing in our district, which I think will help inform a bit of the of our next steps. One of them was the question of algebra and the dilemma that many of us find ourselves in. That the state has adopted a two-tiered eighth grade math program, general math and a algebra one. In our district, we've had the policy over for the last number of years that all eighth graders take algebra one. And there are, realistically, there are a few exceptions for students with exceptional needs, but that's on the order of 15 or 20 students out of, you know, 1,000 who are not taking algebra. And we started looking at the data to ask ourselves, is this a good decision for students? Is it helping them? There was a recent article that came out from EdSource that looked at students' performance between 7th and 8th grade math. And but they acknowledged that they missed a piece, and that is 8th grade algebra to 9th grade, what happens in 9th grade. And we looked particularly at the 8th grade students in algebra who didn't do well enough to go to geometry, the ones who had to take algebra again. And found some very positive and encouraging results. And that was basically the students who were the neediest, the students who had scored the lowest in eighth grade algebra, these are students who had scored at that far below basic band, those are the ones who made the most gains taking algebra again in ninth grade. The students who scored a little bit higher at the below basic, they also made gains. Not quite as great, but they also made gains. The students who scored at the basic band, they also made gains in ninth grade. So the fear sometimes is that you're hurting students by putting them in algebra too early. What we're finding is that we're helping students by putting them in algebra early. It gives them an exposure to it. It gives them some support and some time to develop some understanding of it. And then they're able to move forward in ninth grade and complete the course. So we're very pleased with that. And the other comment regarding some of the work we've done in our district relates to what Mrs. Harris was just talking about in terms of computer assessments and computer-based assessments. One of the things that we looked at in our district, we have all of our writing, we have, as many districts do, have a writing assessment that happens towards the end of the year just so that we can see how well our students are doing. In our district, it's expository or information-based writing. And partly that was because of the feedback we're getting from the colleges that our kids need to be better prepared to write college thesis papers. And so we started, and we moved that all the way down to kindergarten. So all of our students do an expository writing benchmark. And a few years ago, we had a grant from an agency that allowed us to purchase a automated computer-based scoring system and to use those facilities for analyzing the results. And there was interest in seeing how that would happen. And there were also some doubts. I frankly had some doubts myself because I wasn't sure that a computer could score a writing assessment as well as a teacher could. So we took about 20% of the papers and double scored them. We sent them off to be scored by the computer, but we also brought in teachers like we normally do to score the papers. And what we found was quite validating of the role of teachers, and that is that the teachers were able to score papers with much more nuanced understanding of what should be in a paper, whereas the computer at that time was really looking simply at issues of subject-verb agreement, capitalization, punctuation, was very, very focused on pieces of writing which are important, and the teachers also picked those up, but the teachers picked up other aspects about style and organization and a sense of voice and purpose and how well the paper addressed the focus of the prompt. So as we move forward in this process, the decisions that we'll make about which of the assessment consortiums to belong to are very important, because what I see is having the teacher's voice there and teacher's experience and participation there front and center is really essential for good teaching and for good assessment for our students. So I really support the consideration of how much teachers are involved in the assessment development and analysis. The other thing that we're seeing is just the importance of working with English learners and understanding that as a state we have a huge responsibility to support English learners. We also have a bit of a track record that is not publicly acknowledged, and that is that under our current standards, the 1997 standards, once the standards-based test came in 2002 until this past year, the achievement gap between English speakers and English learners has actually grown every single year. And that has not been publicly acknowledged. I've presented some of that data at a couple conferences that I've been invited to. But it's an issue that speaks to the importance of us as a state making sure that the piece that in the Common Core standards that's not there is how does this align for the development of language for English learners? And do we have have we aligned the standards to that, and have we provided the training and support for that as well? Because we have to, you know, it's just not acceptable that an achievement gap is growing every year. We need to address that in a very forthright manner. Okay. Thank you very much.
Norby has a question for you.
My impression is that kids are being reclassified English speaking sooner and more aggressively than before. Is that accurate?
It may be accurate. In our district, we have been able to do that, but many districts have done that because some of the recommendations that have come down for the achievement right. level that the students need to have okay. and on the CSTs, the indicator was lowered.
And yeah, I was wondering if that has to do with the gap, because I think in the past kids would be classified as English language learners indefinitely and would stay in the program. I remember I had a straight A student who was a senior in high school, and they pulled her out every couple of months because she was still classified English language learner. And maybe those kids are being reclassified. A lot of it has to do with that.
Usually, most districts look at a couple different things, such as the student's performance on the CELT test, the language, mm-hmm. English language development test, their performance on the CSTs, and their grades. What happened over the last couple of years is the recommendation for the CST scores for their cut point for that dropped. What happened in our district is we kept the cut point higher, mm-hmm. and we're still able to reclassify more students because of some of the work that we've been doing. Additionally, what we did is we looked at our cut point in relationship to passing the CAISY, because we wanted to make sure that we didn't reclassify a student away from supports if they were unlikely to pass the CAISY. So we did some backward checking on our data to determine what would be an appropriate level of performance so that we could pretty much guarantee that if a child was reclassified, you knew they were going to be able to pass CAISY and graduate.
Okay.
It is a complex issue, though.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions from members? I had a question back on the eighth grade algebra issue, and I really agree with all of the comments that my colleagues have made. Teachers should be able to use their professional judgment with regards to pacing. We need to, you know, push decisions down on the local level. One size doesn't fit all. But do you think that there should be any policy from the state level to address this issue as we move ahead, or is it just a matter of districts being aware and trying to take their own course of action? I mean, I certainly like your solution and believe it to be true that if you expose those kids to algebra in the eighth grade, and I think some of the data certainly in the school district that you were in at one point and I was in at one point certainly demonstrated that as well, that they tend to do better, achieve higher in ninth grade in repeating the subject area. But is that something that you just think should be left alone?
I think that's a very interesting question because it really raises the question of how much direction comes from the state, how much direction comes from the district. The problem that I often see is unless you're in a district with a board that's particularly interested in looking at the consequences of some of the decisions that you make, whatever the consequences are, whatever the decisions are, you often don't know. And people operate oftentimes on past practice or beliefs. what is important, I think, is to if you're going to take a position, check it out and see if it works, and find out if this is the right approach or not. So that, first of all, so that we make good decisions by students. Secondly, so that we can work together collaboratively in understanding how do we make this the best decision for students. There is a concern that in the issue of tracking, of who is tracked at the lower level, and how are those decisions made? And there's so many variables that feed into those decisions. One, in the district where I am currently, when I first got there, we found out that only the super advanced students were being put into algebra in eighth grade. In other words, not even all the advanced kids, none of the proficient kids. And we found that, yes, those kids did very well, but we found other kids who could do well, too. Now, it required us to be creative, to look for a lot of supports for students, to have a network of supports actually that reaches back down into the elementary grades, and to look at it systemically. I think my personal philosophy is I have not yet seen creating higher standards necessarily hurt people. We rise to the occasion. We figure out how to do it better. Some students will begin to fly and to soar. Others, it'll take more work on our part to support them. But I think what we want for our state is students who are functioning at the highest level they possibly can. So.
Thank you, Ms. Buchanan.
Yeah, I believe in higher standards. I believe that those students who want to challenge themselves should be able to challenge themselves, whether it's math or language arts or in whatever subject area, because it's amazing how oftentimes they'll rise to the occasion. I've also seen studies, though, in math where if you try and push kids too fast, their ultimate level of achievement in math, moving on high school and college, is actually lower than if you have instruction that's appropriate to their skill level. And, you know, I also believe that, you know, what you're talking about is why we need good teacher-made formative assessments, because it's not just the score they get on the test they take in April. You know, you've got to be able to dig underneath the data so, you know, you can inform instruction and you understand where the gaps are and how you're continually improving instruction, because to the extent we're able to do that and have kids well prepared long before they get into eighth grade algebra, we're going to guarantee their success. Because I don't think the magic starts in eighth grade. It starts with what we're doing back in elementary school and how we're preparing our students.
I think you're absolutely right in terms of having good formative assessments and the ability of all of us as educators to know how our kids are doing and know what the next step is to help them do better. In our particular system, we use a matrix of indicators for making decisions about students. And what we're finding is that the indicator that best facilitates the students getting access to a higher level class is whichever one it is works the best.
In terms of looking at other states and the progress that they're making around this area of Common Core implementation, are there states that you would recommend to us in this point in time for us to watch and look at as a potential model?
You know, I'm sorry, I really don't know. However, I do know that the staff from the California Department of Education has had an opportunity, and they can probably speak to that more than I, to be in some national meetings with representatives from other states and to begin the conversation around what are the best next steps for people. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kaminsky. Thank you for being here. Your school district is fortunate to have you, and we're fortunate to have you here today. So thank you very, very much. And we will move on to our last panel, who's here to talk about challenges and opportunities in implementing the Common Core standards. And we're going to start this last panel with Edgar Cabral from the LAO's office, and he's going to give us an overview of the fiscal challenges and talk about some of the opportunities we may have going forward. You have a handout?
Good Good afternoon. Edgar Cabral with the Legislative Analyst Office. And the handout that I have is being passed out for you. I wanted to touch efforts generally on some of the basic background on the curriculum frameworks and the instructional materials adoption process. Then talk a little bit about the current situation with them due to some suspensions due to the flexibility adopted a few years ago. And then some of the opportunities or issues in terms of implementing restarting the process again and implementing the Common Core standards. Just to touch briefly on the processes, the curriculum frameworks adoption process is intended to have a framework that provides guidance for how to teach the content standard in a given subject for teachers. It includes information on instructional approaches for helping students master the content standards, professional development that could be beneficial, requirements for instructional materials, and instructional strategies for some particular groups of students. These frameworks are adopted prior to the adoption of instructional materials, and the frameworks are used in the adoption process. In terms of instructional materials adoption, the state is required, or the State Board of Education is required to adopt standards-aligned instructional materials for grades K through 8. High school materials are adopted separately. They're adopted at the local level. The state adopts new materials for most subjects every 6 years, and school districts are required to purchase those materials every 24 months after the adoption. These adoptions are staggered, so the costs are not, they don't come in every 6 years. There's every year or so there's a different adoption that districts will need to do. And there's a variety of things that are criteria for evaluating the materials. There's academic context standards, the curriculum frameworks. There are some program evaluation criteria based on the specific type of material, whether it's for example, for basic grade level or for struggling students. And then there are a variety of social content standards. And California is unique in that it's the only state that has a hybrid process. We have half of the process is for K through 8, it's adopted at the state level, and then high school is adopted at the local level. On page 2, we talked a little bit about the current process has been suspended because of some decisions in February 2009 related to flexibility. So the instructional materials process, the framework process, are all suspended until 2013-14. The school districts at this point can use their instructional materials block grant funding for any purpose. So the funding is not being used necessarily on materials. And that, at this point under current law, those provisions would expire at the end of the 2013-14 fiscal year. The governor's budget, however, proposed to extend those provisions for 2 additional years, and so they wouldn't expire until 2015-16. And the current conference committee budget, which is combining of the Senate and Assembly packages, both have the flexibility extending for the 2 additional years. So this is important for you to keep in mind if you're looking to resurrect the existing or the old system and starting to come back and start developing curriculum frameworks again. You need to start those a few years before you'd start the adoption process, and you need to provide some funding for that. And that would be, we think, at the state level in terms of curriculum, the curriculum commission was about $800,000 in funding at the Department of Education. But also at the local level, school districts right now could be spending that money on anything. It could be on teacher salaries. They could have spent it for a variety of purposes. And so if, to the extent that we're going to resurrect the process, districts will need to know ahead of time so that they are able to plan for using the funding for instruction materials again. In terms of transitioning to Common Core, we can move to the next page. The suspension in some ways makes it a little bit easier because there's no existing adoption process right now that you would have to stop immediately as you move to Common Core. The entire process has been suspended for over a year. The important questions related to Common Core really are how are you going to start your system again, and how is Common Core going to require you to make changes or would necessitate changes? So, for example, we have a curriculum frameworks process right now that's California specific. Does California need to continue to do that? If you have a Common Core standards that lots of states have now agreed to use, can there be some national group or some other state that develops some frameworks that the state could then use instead of having to go through your own process? In terms of instructional materials, it's the same issue. You know, California has a very specific, unique adoption process. If you have Common Core standards and there is an entity that's going to tell you that these specific materials are aligned with the Common Core standards, to what extent does California need to develop its own adoption process and approval? We think that it would be beneficial if California could be part of a national market for materials that could provide more choice and potentially could lower costs and improve quality. But that would depend a lot on how much the state decided to implement in terms of details in the adoption process, additional criteria that would be the state would impose. We have recommended in the past some recommendations for streamlining the system. For example, we've recommended splitting the framework process apart from the instructional material adoption process so that they would not necessarily be used for adopting materials. They would be advisory so that districts and teachers can use those for as a pedagogical tool, but it wouldn't necessarily be used in terms of adopting materials. We've also recommended allowing districts to use materials for two cycles. So just because there's a new adoption doesn't mean you have to, if a school district is comfortable with the materials and there are not very many changes in a new adoption, that you could continue to use those old materials. And then finally, enhancing information sharing so that districts know not just which materials are adopted, but also quality. In the current process, districts just know that the state has adopted materials. They don't know whether there were some preference, there were particular materials that reviewers thought were more effective than others. So those are some of the things you might want to keep in mind in terms of when you start building the new system again and start developing an adoption process, whether you want to continue the old one or you want to potentially streamline it, given that we now could be part of a national market.
Thank you. Questions? Do you have any sense, have you looked into what the LEO's estimation is in terms of how much it's going to cost the state to go through this process in a high-quality way?
We haven't looked into too much detail. We know definitely right now there is no funding for the Curriculum Commission itself, so that we think is in the neighborhood of $800,000, or that's equivalent to what the governor vetoed a few years ago related to the commission. So you would need to provide additional funding for the department to have funding to start working on building the frameworks. That in terms of statewide, that would be the biggest particular concern. In terms of materials at the district level, I know that my understanding is that a lot of school districts, in terms of buying books, they don't necessarily just use the funding for that specific year. They might have been saving money over time to have enough money to buy the new adoptions. Right now, given that districts are using that money for any purpose, it's probably not being saved in the bank waiting for the new adoption. And so districts will need to have some time to plan ahead of time to make sure that they have some set aside funding for new adopted materials. I think those would be the two bigger issues.
And did I hear you say that the LAO would recommend for consideration for California to look at other states' framework adoptions?
Right. We think that to the extent that California remains part of this, is using Common Core standards, and I know that there are some differences in terms of additional standards and California may have adopted, particularly related to algebra. But to the extent that the standards are similar across the country, then you could use materials that might not necessarily be designed specifically for California. Similarly, there could be frameworks that you could use that are designed for the Common Core standards that are not necessarily California specific. And if there is something that people think is a good product and is available from another state, then there might not necessarily be a need to go through a California specific framework adoption.
Thank you. In my earlier question about the cost, you mentioned the Curriculum Commission, instructional materials, and part of the testimony today, there was an emphasis from the teachers in school districts that we put an emphasis particularly on professional development. And do you have any sense about costs there through past practice or past models?
Yeah, that would, I think, vary depending on how in-depth you want it to go. For example, I know that in the past when the content standards were passed in the late 90s, there was some additional funding so that teachers could spend several days on professional development training specifically for these new standards. I think it really depends on how how much of time you want teachers to take before they go and implement the standards, and how many days really of professional development you want. So I think we haven't really done a particular estimate, but it would be depending on the length that you'd want.
Thank you, Mr. Cabral. And now we have some representatives from the Superintendent of Public Instruction, Tom Torlakson's office, and the transition team. And we have Aaron Gable, who is the Director of Legislative Affairs at the California Department of Education. Welcome, Aaron. Thank you for being here.
Great. Thank you very much, Chairwoman Brownlee. On behalf of State Superintendent Public Instruction, Tom Torlakson, I just want to thank the committee for having this really in-depth process for looking at what he would like the legislature to consider as an opportunity. The vacuum that has been created by the fiscal crisis that we are in the midst is an opportunity that has now become critical in that we are facing the implementation of Common Core in a very quick timeline that our local school districts and our teachers and the students are facing in terms of being assessed perhaps as early as 2015 on the Common Core standards. And what process do we look at in the short and long term in order to learn what we can from California's previous process before it was put on hold, and think in the short term about how we can make sure that teachers and students have what they need in order to succeed. We are looking forward to working with many members of this House, as well as in the Senate, the Chairwoman included, on looking at some of those short and long-term strategies, many of which were actually referred to by previous panelists, and so we won't belabor the issues today, but looking at the short-term needs of bridging materials, looking at the long-term needs of what is the full and complete system that we have and getting ready for these assessments. And here from the department and also from the superintendent's transition team. We have two members with us. We're going to sort of treat ourselves as one panel. And so however you'd like to conduct questions, just, you know, we're going to be very flexible. We're in the midst of a very wonderful process here at the Department of Education with the transition in of the new superintendent. He is wanting to ask, as the committee is, the big questions of what comes next. How can we be most thoughtful in this budget crisis with the systems that we have? How can we be smarter with the funds that we have? And how can we fill the void that's there with the best process possible? And we have a number of wonderful individuals who are serving on his transition advisory team. Shelley's here today to represent them. It's being chaired by Dr. Linda Darling-Hammond from Stanford University and David Rattray from the Los Angeles Chamber of Commerce. And they're looking at a number of different issues, including that of curriculum delivery and the future of it in California. There had been some questions earlier today, and I have to apologize on behalf of Deb Sigmund. She's our deputy superintendent over all of the areas you're discussing today. Would love to be here answering all of your questions in depth. Unfortunately, she's in front of the state board today answering some of the very same questions. So if there's anything that comes up today that we are not able to adequately answer, we will make sure to get with her and get those answers to you. And as you continue what appears to be a series of discussions on these areas and move into assessment, she hopes to be with you and we can get deep into the details. But to answer some of the questions that it asked, so the State Board did have an information item today on the assessment consortia issue. And I know that's not going to be discussed fully today, but we can answer any questions you might have. But it was just an informational item to reiterate the process question. The decision on whether to stay the course with our current consortia or to change direction is a joint decision between the governor, the superintendent of public instruction, and the president of the state board. So while the state board doesn't have a formal role in the decision-making process, it's the chair that has the vote, so to speak. He is going through this public deliberative process to get the input of the state board. And while the legislature themselves does not have an official vote, so to speak, we would really hope that during this time we are being asked to to either confirm our participation in the PARC consortia or to change direction within the next 5 months, actually now within the next 3 months, by the end of May. And while that's not a set-in-stone timeline, it is one we're trying to respect because of the idea that we want to be leaders at the table. It's very important if California is going to be looking at these consortia and their assessment models as the direction we want to take our assessment systems here in California, that we be at the table in the nuts and bolts design of those priorities and what those systems are going to contain, and so that we would love to get the feedback of the members of the legislature as soon as possible as to how you feel about the both consortia and their underlying concepts. So with that, I wanted to turn over the presentation to Shelley Spiegel-Coleman, who is here on behalf of our Transition Advisory Committee. Thank you.
Thank you and welcome. Thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much. It's my pleasure to be here, and I think it's very convenient that you scheduled this in the afternoon so we could be at the board meeting in the morning and kind of get the breadth and depth of all the conversations that are taking place. My name is Shelley Spiegel-Coleman. I'm the Executive Director of Californians Together, but I am so honored to be here on behalf of Superintendent Tom Torlakson's transition team. This is just a tremendous amount of work that the team is doing, but with much energy and much dedication, and the people are just represent a whole breadth and depth of our community, very concerned about our schools. I want to start off with some general statements about the work of our committee, and then I'm going to give you some specific recommendations that are cooking, because we're not done yet, so I want to give you a flavor of what we're into. The charge for our committee, the Curriculum and Assessment Committee, is to make recommendations towards the implementation of California's Common Core standards and the development and implementation of a 21st century curriculum and assessments. We see the implementation of California's Common Core as a real opportunity to reframe the conversation about curriculum, instruction, assessment, and professional development. To be able to deliver a technology-supported 21st century education, enabling students to develop deep understanding with and across all subject content areas, to involve complex thinking and performance skills, a global perspective including multiple languages and multiple perspectives, and the capacity for inquiry, collaborative, and independent learning. The new Common Core English Language Arts and Math standards require a more integrated approach to delivering content across all subject areas. The Common Core standards in English Language Arts are written to include critical thinking, reading and writing, speaking and listening in history, in science, in mathematics, and arts, as well as in the English classroom. The Common Core standards in mathematics are written to include the use of mathematical skills in the fields of science, technology, and engineering. So these standards emphasize the ways in which students should use literacy and numeracy skills across the curriculum and in life skills. As we develop curriculum to implement these standards, we should also be examining how our standards in other subject areas can be made compatible with the Common Core standards, and how all of this would be able to ensure critical thinking, performance skills that are applicable to complex problems and the world beyond school. The Common Core standards are written to ensure that every student becomes college and career ready. To ensure that students reach this goal, we believe every student should have the opportunity to pursue a multiple pathway curriculum with permeable pathways that allow them to prepare for college and or career simultaneously. The curriculum should be developmentally appropriate, linguistically and culturally respectful, and to build upon the cultural and diversity and the strengths of our California student population. Finally, as citizens in the global society, we believe that every student in California should be literate in English and one or more languages and recognized for those skills that they develop. As you can see, this would require our schools to do things very differently, pre-K through 12th grade. We are assuming an expansion of a curriculum-rich concept that would allow students to develop concepts across disciplines, promoting student engagement in real-life application while analyzing world and local problems. We are not satisfied on the transition team with the narrow curriculum that leaves many of our students languishing in intervention programs for two-thirds of the day without any access to science, social science, or the arts. So here are some of our recommendations that are taking shape. Not quite there yet, but gives you a feel. We believe, one, that every student must have access to a full curriculum, pre-K through 12th grade, that includes science, history, social science, language and arts, in addition to language, arts, and math. We believe that the new curriculum frameworks will be needed to address subject areas in order to implement the Common Core standards. And the new framework should present an integrated approach to delivering content and skills instruction across subject areas. Our third recommendation, and I think that Dr. Kaminsky spoke to it, we have seen that the Common Core standards did not address the issue of English learners and how their language development feeds into these Common Core standards. So we are hoping that the English language development standards and language arts standards in other languages be revised, rewritten, and aligned to the Common Core standards. We see all content teachers needing to be able to provide language development and literacy within their content, and professional development for that is going to be critical. California needs to implement a new literacy campaign enlisting all members of our community to support all students becoming proficient and critical readers beginning in preschool through 12th grade, with the breadth and depth of oral, written, and reading skills needed for college and career readiness. And a new approach to developing, adopting, and or recommending instructional materials needs to be created to provide a broader range of high-quality options, both in hard copy and digitally formatted. And second to last, as the budget, we hope, improves, we would like California to move as quickly as possible to funding a one-to-one computer-to-student ratio for grades 4 and above. The cost of a $250 netbook, which gives unlimited access to curriculum materials and instructional support, is equal to two textbooks from our different adoptions. Lastly, we should explicitly educate and assess our students in the use of the 21st century tools so that they're able to sort through all the results they can get from searches, so that they can think critically about what's important, to be able to collaborate with their peers in solving complex real problems, and to communicate their views effectively in writing and through oral presentations. We look forward to seeing these recommendations, and maybe others, becoming a reality for all of California students. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much. Questions, Ms. Buchanan?
I'll wait till we have the last panelist.
Okay, that sounds very good. And our last panelist is Mr. Tom Adams, who is the director of the Standards Curriculum Frameworks and Instructional Resources Division at the California Department of Education. So thank you. Thank you for being here.
And thank you. I'll be brief. I do have an unplugged version of a PowerPoint in front of you and handouts, but I'm not going to go through every slide. I'm going to many of these issues you've heard before, but I do want to make you aware that the implementation of a Common Core is an implementation of an entire system. We have adopted the Common Core standards, and we are beginning efforts in terms of implementing them, in terms of providing professional development online, as well as going to various conferences. But I do want to make one thing clear, is that when we adopted the Common Core, we entered into a dialogue with all the other Common Core states. So we said we're going to share the same standards for students in all 45 states now that have adopted the Common Core. And that's a profound decision by the state. One of the things that we did this for two reasons. One, you can say, is just for our own self-regard in terms of the Common Core updating our standards, creating a better design, and thereby making a better instruction in our schools. Second of all, it had the benefit of our state's children. that if they go to another Common Core state, they don't slip through the cracks. They actually can pick up pretty easily, knowing where they should be. If they've left California at fifth grade and moved to Vermont in sixth grade, everyone knows what they should and be able to do. So in that sense, that's one of the great benefits of the Common Core. The issue of developing curriculum frameworks in the state is, of course, going to be a new dialogue. We are, again, looking at what materials are being developed in other states by different consortiums. The various assessment consortia are developing support materials, so we will be have to be paying attention to that as well. But remember that the frameworks always address this question of how. Well, if the standards answer the question of what, frameworks answer the question of how. And I would always like to have a California-specific document, because California teachers have their own expertise based upon California's unique needs, and we certainly need to provide some guidance on that. In terms of the adoption of instructional materials, just to let you know, if you flip through the timelines there, you can see right now in terms of traditional processes, we're behind. Whether we have action this year or we let the clock run out in terms of the moratorium on curriculum framework and instructional materials adoption. So in that sense, my point being is that on the instructional materials, we have an opportunity to move forward in a different way, different than we have in the past. But we should also be aware that one of the benefits of adopting the Common Core and having materials based upon them is California, for the first time, can benefit from a law that is often known as the Most Favored Nation Clause. This law simply states that if people in California purchase a textbook and the same content is provided in another state and that book is charged at a lower price, then we get the lowest price. And so that allows us to do this, actually enforce it. Up to this point, we've had unique California textbooks. However, that doesn't mean we abandon our commitment to our complex demography in this state and make sure and that we continue to serve the needs of all students. You know, while I love my colleagues in Vermont and Maine, it's not the same population as what you would find here in California. Lastly, the issue of professional development. One thing to keep in mind is professional development dollars have been flexed, and so we cannot guarantee that, the money that was there is being spent on professional development. The other thing is we do not have a legislatively authorized professional development program calling for the focus to be on the Common Core standards. In terms of assessment, I think you will hear you will benefit more from a hearing on that. It's a very complex issue, but what I really wanted to stress in the end is the Common Core provide us a great opportunity for not only improving our standards, but for improving instruction, our support for teachers, and to actually, as someone said, move our schools into the 21st century.
Thank you very much. Ms. Buchanan?
I have a long list, but since there aren't a whole lot of us left, I hope that you'll indulge me. And I want to apologize to Dr. Weiss, because I always enjoy your presentations. You know, when we did the hearings on Race to the Top and all of that, I appreciate your knowledge and all the insight you have. So I sort of feel with common standards torn between a rock and a hard spot. I mean, I definitely believe that going to national common standards makes sense. And I really applaud your enthusiasm and many of your goals, you know, as I list, Shelley, as I heard you, I mean, there's the same, many of the goals are the same as we heard when we were developing standards. We've had in education, we tend to be eternal optimists, and we want what's best for our children. We want a great system. And in California, we have that reality that we face all the time in terms of how we fund our schools. So I'm going to sort of ramble a little bit and ask some questions, but The first question I have to ask is, given that any system or organization can only absorb so much stress at any time, is now the time to adopt common standards? And I say that because in 1997, when we first started adopting California standards, we spent $1.3 billion per subject area adopting standards. $1.3 billion. And at the time, we actually did a pretty good job with in-servicing and training and getting them out. And it was amazing to me as I visited schools and was in classrooms how much, you know, we were able to have a really coherent process in adopting those standards. And now, certainly, we can make the choice, as the LAO said, in terms of saying, okay, you don't have flexibility with your textbook dollars anymore. But we have a situation where we've cut over $7 billion out of education. We have, about $8 billion in deferrals with districts that are in jeopardy of going bankrupt. We have the Fordham Institute that rated our standards, California standards, second highest in the nation, higher than the common standards. We have common standards that we know have gaps. And both of you, it's been brought up in several panels in terms of special education and English learners. So my first question to you is now the time, or should we, should we take a little bit longer look at this, knowing that our standards are already higher, and allow our system to work through this stressful time that we're going through?
Thank you for that question, Assemblywoman. I know that the debate was a long and hard one that this body undertook around the conversation of whether or not to compete and race for the top, and whether or not to look at the Common Core conversation as an opportunity to update our standards despite the fiscal situation we were facing. And I don't think that the concerns have been alleviated in any way, particularly since we did not receive the Race for the Top funds, as the superintendent noted earlier. And so we are struggling, absolutely, with both the time crunch and the financial crunch of the implications of implementing these Common Core standards. But the process that California did undertake was a very deliberative one. The commission did an incredible job in doing a crosswalk between California's very high and rigorous standards and what had been produced for the Common Core, and produced a standards document that many believe is a step forward, and particularly in helping provide focus within our standards, and that necessary update, since we had not updated our standards for over, I believe, 12 years for English language arts and mathematics, and we still have not updated them for history and for science, that was an absolutely crucial step we needed to take despite the budgetary implications that we're faced with. But that doesn't, of course, fully answer your question, which is, then how do we do this now? And I think that as many folks who came before us on the panels have discussed, we do need to think smarter about the funds that we do have that are currently allocated for our assessments and for instructional materials and for a lot of the funds that are now in flex in terms of professional development, and think very comprehensively about the system, the whole system, in getting ready for the assessments that are coming. And because the standards have been adopted, we do have to do our very best to make sure that our students are prepared to be held accountable to performance on those standards, and to make sure that our schools have the best materials possible. And there are a number of strategies we can do, both short and long term, in order to try to get there. And I think taking advantage of the national scale of the Common Core, so that we can save money and be working together with other states anywhere we can, whether it be the market conversation around instructional materials or professional development or anything else, that there's a lot to be gained there. But it's still going to be a huge challenge.
Where are you going to get the money for instructional materials?
That's a very good question. We don't.
Because if you adopt new standards and you can't fund instructional materials, I'd say you'd have a big problem.
Yes.
And if you force school districts to give up that flexibility and eliminate counselors or close more libraries or increase more class sizes, then I would say you might be creating a bigger problem than you're solving, given the fact that our standards are higher. I applaud everything you're doing. I just question to what extent it might make sense to pull back and say, we've done some great work. Let's figure out how we're going to implement this in an even in a more thoughtful manner, because if you implement new standards, you also have to implement new assessments, because your assessments have to align with those standards. You've got to renorm. Most districts are having to give up that 3 days of in-service that we have, and without that they've got zero in-service, because that's the only way they can save program. So we've got this sort of perfect storm lining up, and there's an old saying in data processing that I often quote, and that is that users can make a good system fail or a bad system succeed. But I just don't know how we add that much more strain on our system right now when our standards are already higher than the Common Core standards. Because there's not, I mean, you look at the money situation, and I don't know where it's coming from. I mean, the reason the governor's asking for an extension of the temporary revenues is because all the economists agree that it's going to be 5 or 6 years before we move out of this recession and get our employment levels down to a point where we can truly start restoring. And in education, when we start restoring, we may want to get down below class sizes of 40 plus at the high school or 30 at the elementary school level. So I'm hearing what you're saying. I'm just saying that I'm not sure, given that it cost us $1.3 billion per subject area back in 1997 to do it right, that we're not being a little bit naive here and thinking that we can somehow, on a hope and a prayer, make this happen, and without putting additional stress on a system that's under tremendous stress right now. So that, I've got, you know, other questions, but basically, you know, thoughtful and smarter to me means that you make sure that you can do it in a way that works, that you set up a system that's designed for success, not designed for failure. And right now, I think if we move full steam ahead, and that's not saying that I don't believe we should have it, but I think if we try and move full steam ahead and put more stress on the system, we're probably going to create, we're probably going to result in failure. And not success, because everything has to line up together. And there are some districts that are borderline bankrupt right now, just with the deferrals that we're giving them.
Please.
So I know we can focus on materials, because I know that's a significant cost. But I have to say, what we've been doing in the past is only focusing on the materials. All our professional development that we have done in the past has only been on implementing the materials. We have avoided really providing professional development for our teachers and for our administrators on what it really means to deliver standards-based instruction with a real high level of sophistication in terms of our craft. And what I want to say from the presentations this morning that I heard at the State Board, in terms of the testing consortiums, they were given a $30 million augmentation precisely to provide professional development to the states that are working with them in their consortiums. And part of that was to really develop a cadre of leaders in the states to really do professional development on the standards so that people and the teachers would be prepared for the exams that will be coming afterwards. I think this is an opportunity that we have to take, because if not, we're going to be in the same situation that we are in now. And for many of our student populations, English learners in particular, the gap is growing. The materials that we have sitting in the classrooms were not developed appropriately to address their language and literacy needs. And so I think if we can take the first step of looking at these Common Core standards, improving our English language development standards to align with them, and really do professional development on what it means to deliver standards-based instruction, the issue of the materials for me is not as big an issue as this first one is. And I think to take a look at that piece might not be as costly, assuming that we might be getting some of the support from the assessment consortiums that was described in significant detail this morning at the State Board.
Well, first of all, $30 million is far short of the $1.3 billion per subject
area. And that's in addition to all that they have.
Secondly,
already.
I would say that the instructional material cost is far less than the cost of in-service and training. That in-service and training is the key component. And I don't, when you say we didn't do any in-service and training, I beg to differ with you. I know in Contra Costa County, I attended the consortiums. I know in our district we did extensive, I don't know about Santa Clara, but my guess is they did extensive training with teachers, teaching them how to deliver content. When you look at your own scores, the achievement gap is closing. You're seeing higher test scores. And I'm not saying that I don't agree with everything you're saying. Again, and we could argue this point for a long time. I just ask the question, do we do it because we're all enthusiastic and believe it's the right thing to do, or do we do it in a more thoughtful way where we make sure we've got the funding there for the training and in-service of everyone, where we have the money for the instructional materials, where we have, I mean, not just in-service do we need in on the standards and on in training, but we need in-service in terms of the new assessments and the alignments, and all of that has to fit together, and we can't even get CalPADS up and running on top of all that. So I think there's a great deal to do, and I think if you don't have the build a new system on a strong foundation, you really risk having cracks in the walls and having the whole thing crumble. So again, I find myself torn. I believe it's the right thing we need to do. I just question whether how we implement it over time and whether now is the right time given the stress. And I myself would not vote to pull the rug under schools, for example, to demand that to take away the flexibility on instructional materials right now, when I know that, you know, it might mean the difference in a library being open or a child having a counselor or being in a class size that's much bigger.
I just want to weigh in on the conversation here a little bit too, because I agree with my colleague that we, if we're going to do this, we need to do it right and to make sure that we have the resources to invest in it. On the other hand, I think we can go into the process with eyes wide open, a process that's articulated, eyes wide open. We can't predict what our financial situation is going to be, you know, 3 or 4 years down the road. We just can't predict it. I think that, but I think that we can move with professional development, which I think is one of my big takeaways in this hearing, is that investment in the professional development piece and the instructional materials being an important part, but not as important in terms of moving ahead with the Common Core standards. It's more diminished. You know, we can delay instructional materials for a bit, I think, in this process. Clearly, instructional materials are going to be important, but at the beginning of this process, which is not, it's a significant investment because it's an investment in professional development, and I think it's an investment in sort of a continuous professional development that we have to sustain over time, and we're gonna have to work through the investment process of it. I don't think we're talking about eliminating flexibility at this particular point in time. That's in the budget. That's on the table. We're gonna have to work through that. But I think the purpose here and now is to begin to look at a process by which we implement this. I also think that we have, it's a different time and day. We have 44, I don't know what the number is, states that are engaged in this, and I think we have the ability to sort of share in expertise and share in resources that would make it not as expensive. It's going to be, I don't want to diminish the investment here, but I do think that we have those resources, shared resources, that California will benefit from. And again, you know, this is just one step, one baby step in terms of determining and moving forward and trying to establish a process by which we can debate the timelines in that and how long or how short it's going to be. And I think that's relative to the amount of resources that we can invest into it. But so
I guess go ahead. What I would suggest, and I think we basically agree, the story I would tell is we were implementing a new web-based IEP system, Genesee. There's several out there, and you're probably familiar with them. And the thought was sort of in our district, well, we're going to have our IT people install it for us, and it's just all going to come together. And there was a committee of us, and we, you know, as soon as you recognize talking to other districts that it's not just the cost of the IP and the additional hardware servers you need, but you had to train every special ed staff, you know, to be able to do it. There's time involved in putting in those first IEPs, even though the subsequent ones go in faster. We had to buy a laptop for everyone because now we expected them to do the IEPs on computers. And so there were all the costs that went into it, and we had, compared to some other districts, an extremely successful implementation. But we knew what those upfront costs were, which, by the way, I think the software is around $250,000. We figured out our total cost to implement was about $1.4 million plus ongoing cost of $300,000 a year for just ongoing replacement and everything. So my suggestion or request would be that as you do your planning, that we just don't say these are the standards and give them to districts and say this is what you have to do. But if you believe that it's important to have quality instructional materials, if you believe that in-service and training is an integral part of having a successful implementation, integral part of ongoing development because we have new teachers that come in every year, that part of your plan outline what the costs are for a good, successful implementation, because then I think you will have tremendous buy-in from county offices of ed, from local school districts, and we will be extremely successful in doing it. And those are things that we have to know. And if you're doing planning, that cost planning should be part of what a successful implementation is.
Anybody have some response to that, or the panel want to make a response? Not required. I had a few small questions, and then I think we can begin to wrap up and maybe take some public comment. But I just wanted to get a little further clarification on the professional development that you talked about that's online at the Department of Education's website.
We link to it from the Department of Education, but one of the things we have done is partnered. And we've created our own page on CDE on iTunes U.
And on what?
CDE on iTunes U. iTunes U from Apple. They donated the server space for us, and we are putting up their various presentations done by national figures as well as department folks. And we also solicit contributions from districts and county folks if they have done presentations on providing professional development to teachers, not just simply the Common Core, but other subject areas. And we hope to have our first webinar posted on there about April or so. And we're going to put about four of them up there, maybe five. And then also we have provided some guidance in terms of an online document called the Grade Level Curriculum. Talks about what subject areas need to be taught according to the state law on the course of study, and then it does have some discussion about transitioning to the Common Core in the areas of mathematics and language arts.
Thank you. And then just a question on technology for a moment. Where is California, relative to the use of technology as part of the instructional materials? Are we way behind? Are there other states that are models on that? I mean, I know that, again, you know, as a school board member, we looked into investing, you know, in a computer for every student, and if we had done that, we would have spent, you know, a lot of money and maybe not have gotten the yield on it that we wanted, and technology continues to change. I mean, I envision one day that students will just be working on their smartphones, and a lot of work can be done there. But I guess the question is kind of, where does California, are we doing anything in that area? Are there some model school districts out there that might be doing something? And are there other states that are really investing a lot of money in this area?
Well, the one figure that comes to mind when discussing California is we have one computer for every six students. So we're a little behind on that in terms of providing every student. However, we do have some...
And that's one generally up-to-date computer?
Yeah.
Okay.
There are states, say, like Florida, that has been very aggressive in this, in their instructional materials front and online course review. California, though, does have a clearinghouse for electronic materials called the California Learning Resources Network. They were instrumental in the free digital textbook initiative. They've done their third phase. More importantly, they're upgrading their review process to align their review of electronic supplemental materials to the Common Core. So we're ahead there. In terms of state-adopted instructional materials, we've always allowed materials in print and non-print, and then if they're adopted as print, we always allow them to have an alternate format in electronically. In terms of our special ed population, and specifically visually impaired and blind students, they have full access to electronic materials, and the department does provide a website to download those files. And I think it's very exciting that if we can move forward and having them using some type of e-reader, it really makes that much more accessible for those students and can enrich their education.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. And I think, you know, and I probably didn't articulate the question very well, but, you know, just sort of kind of looking at this, obviously one of the goals that were articulated is to, for every student to have a computer, but this idea of a notebook, you know, an iPad, whatever it is, for every student, that we don't have hard copy textbooks, that, you know, everything is coming through some, you know, electronic device. I guess, and maybe everything is not the right word on that, but a lot of, potentially a lot of material coming through electronic device. I guess, you know, the question is, I know we're not doing that in California, but are there some school districts that are exploring that, that we can look at, and are other states looking at that kind of technology, I guess, for instruction?
Well, that's a big question, but let me say this. One of the things California did recently in legislation was redefine instructional material so it can include the equipment.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, that itself is a game changer. The biggest hindrance right now is, as Assembly Member Buchanan said, is the fiscal situation, and long-term planning is 6 months.
Yeah, I hear you on that. I just, we have to use the resources that we have now, but just in trying to look at other models out there so that, as Ms. Buchanan said, we can begin to incorporate some planning and have some idea of, you know, cost. And I think a good way to approach that is just to look at other models and people in other states or other districts who are utilizing, seeing how it works, looking at best practices.
There is a member on the transition team on our committee who is doing this one-to-one project in a high school in the Napa Valley. And a paper on that is being written up, and we are looking at an initiative called No Child Left Offline. Mm-hmm. And so there is a really successful work around that area that will be coming out of the committee that will look at a model that they're working on. Very exciting when he's describing it, I have to say.
Great. Well, thank you. I thank all of you for being here and participating in today's discussion. This obviously is an ongoing discussion, but I certainly agree with the superintendent that I really see this as an opportunity, and I really thank all of you for the work that you're doing in this area, and I'm really looking forward to working in concert with you on that so that we can begin to look at a structure and a process by which we can move forward on this. Also having a plan to support it, an investment plan, because, of course, I agree, we want to, if we're going to engage in this, we really want to do it well. And but again, thank you very much for being here and participating. And we'll take a little time for public comments if there's anyone who would like to make a comment at this time. Is there anybody that would like to make a public comment? Seeing none, then again, thank you for all the panelists who participated. We really appreciate it. And with that, we will adjourn this hearing.